Good evening. Welcome to the Berks History Center's monthly Your Berks History Show. My name is Vicky Heffner, and I'm the Education Curator at the Berks History Center. I want to thank the viewers tonight for joining us, and also thank Berks Community Television for hosting the show. Tonight's program is about Let's Go Out to the Ball Game Again. I am joined by BHC Trustee Brian Engelhardt and Trustee and Editor of the Historical Review of Berks County. And I turn it over to these guys who are going to talk about baseball in Reading.
Well, we're going to talk about remembering baseball's time of troubles as a celebration of baseball being back this season. Last year, we didn't have any baseball. The last time we didn't have any baseball in Reading was more than 50 years ago, when between 1961 and 65, three teams left town. On this very artistic lead page, on the left is Gabe Paul, who was the president of the Cleveland Indians, and next to him is Joe Bouzas, who owned the Red Sox franchise in the Eastern League, and they are players in the drama. Next to that is, of course, a Reading Red Sox program and a Reading Indians program. The Indians left town, the Red Sox left town, and the Indians left town. Next. But we're celebrating that baseball's back, but we're remembering these dark days. And I'm calling it the time of troubles because it harkens to the time of troubles in Russian history between 1598 and 1613, when there was a crisis in leadership in the country. It was invaded by foreign countries. It was had poor harvests, famine, plague, roving bands of bandits pillaging the countryside, but no baseball teams left town. No baseball teams.
Is that Daniel Boone or Davy Crockett in the top?
That would be the false Dmitri II. They had three false Dmitris who were imposters. Of the sons of Ivan the Terrible. But there wasn't any of them were real
like
Dmitris.
Davy Crockett to
so,
me.
But anyway, keep that in mind, and that's a picture of a rough time during the time of troubles in Russia. Okay.
When Mother Mary said to me, let it be.
Let it be.
Times of trouble, you know.
In the 1940s, there was no minor league baseball because there was no park. 1943, Lowers Park, which had been built in 1907, was dilapidated, was a structure that was a hazard. And the last time minor league ball was in town was 1941, and it was demolished. And that's what it looked like right before the demolition.
Now, why they couldn't play baseball in that? That looks perfectly good to me.
They had no sense of imagination.
None whatsoever. No
sense of imagination, or they could have integrated it with the environment.
Sure.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Then a field was built. If you build it, they will come. In 1951, and you wrote about this at Cathedral Heights,
that's
right?
Cathedral Heights, yes it is.
They built a baseball stadium, and they were hoping somebody would come because you have to have somebody play there. But right then and there in 1951, they had nobody to come and play. Now, this is the stadium that we have now, but there's a roof now. There's a deck. There's a swimming pool. There's lots of netting. There's lots of improvements that have been made. We'll talk about that later. But right now, all we had in 1951 was a stadium, but a nice one, nice clean stadium. And then in 1952, what came down from the north but the Cleveland Indians minor league team from Wilkes-Barre? Kirby Farrell, ultimately the manager on Cleveland, was the manager of the first Reading Indians team in 1952. Cleveland was a welcome organization to have come here because they were good, except that there was a team called the Yankees, but the Indians kept winning pennants when the Yankees didn't, which was not that often, but they averaged 88 victories a season. They had a good organization and good players.
You know, baseball trivia fans would know, too, possibly interested in one of the guys who brought baseball to Reading, really fought for it hard, was Hank Greenberg.
Yes.
Kind of a big name in baseball, Hank Greenberg. And he was one of the intermediaries between, you know, Major League Ball and the Reading City Council in Municipal Memorial Stadium, as it was called then. Mm-hmm.
Hank Greenberg's an interesting person also with the organization here. Bill Veeck and the Indians organization, Bill Veeck was the owner, and Greenberg, the only organization that was more proactive in integration of its system was the Brooklyn Dodgers. Right. So we had a lot of African-American players in the early years of the Reading Indians where a lot of teams didn't. Yep. And that Greenberg was very much of a leader in that. Mm-hmm. Incidentally, you were a neighbor to Reading Indians, weren't you?
Yeah, my next-door neighbor down at... I live next to Fegley's Restaurant. Anybody out there remembers Fegley's Restaurant? You got a lot of this on your head. I live right next to Fegley's, and right next to the on the other side of the property, our neighbors boarded Reading Indians players, and I was I don't know 11 or 12 years old, and here's these guys, minor league professional baseball players, namely Charlie Kolakowski, you might even be listening, and or watching, and Wynn Hawkins and others, who would actually play catch in the backyard. There was this little kid, like out of some bad movie, looking at them, wishing they'd throw the ball to me. And eventually they did, and I got to know these guys. And
did you catch it?
Probably. Of course.
Yes, of course.
I hope. Right. I don't know. But, yeah, that was they were a community-minded organization. The players boarded. They didn't stay in hotels, for the most part. Mm. They boarded with people, with families and things, yeah.
Well, speaking of the players, there were some notable players on those teams. The 1953 Reading Indians was the best team in the league that year, 101 victories. It's the team itself was put in the Reading Baseball Hall of Fame, and there are personalities on that team. Rocky Colavito was the home run champ in the American League. Billy Harrell was the Eastern League's most valuable player. Herb Score, pictured in the upper left-hand pitch with Kirby Farrell, was the rocket-throwing pitcher whose career was unfortunately ended, like Gil McDougal hit the line drive that hit him on the head, and he was never the same after
socket,
that.
I believe it was.
Yeah,
the eye socket, yeah.
Gordy Coleman had a couple years in his later career for the Cincinnati Reds where he was outstanding, and Joe Altobelli, pictured with Kirby Farrell down low there, was the pennant-winning manager of the Baltimore Orioles eventually. They had 12 future big leaguers on that team. That was just poor speaking. You don't get that many big leaguers on a Class A baseball team. Other alumni of note, Roger Maris, who had the record in baseball for home runs for years, came with the 1955 team. Harold Jones, when the 1960 team hit 34 home runs, which held up as the club of the franchise record until Ryan Howard in 2004. Mudcat Grant had a 15-year career in baseball, very colorful. But Cooter Jones and Carl Mathias, Cooter Jones became a fixture in Reading. Carl Mathias was a native out of Ole High School. You knew Cooter, didn't you, Charlie?
Oh, very well. Yeah, Cooter was a fixture up in the, he was a scorekeeper for the Reading Phillies, Fightin Phils. In the press box, he was a fixture there and quite a colorful character. And I got to know him very well, and then Carl Mathias as well, from Donyoli Valley, Carl Mathias. Yeah.
But anyway, oh, and Dave Mann was an outstanding player for 4 years in the team and amazing
very
career
fast
at Reading,
yeah.
Yes. Sadly, in 1961, they had a bad team. They had a bad team, the last place, and they had a lousy gate, 53,000, which comes to about 800 a game. They didn't have people coming to the games. The home crowds, no, only eight exceeded 1,000, except for Pony Night. Pony Night, 4,100 people came to see them lose to the Johnstown Red Sox. And you say to me, Brian, what is Pony Night? Pony Night was the salvation of attendance for teams just about every year. And for these four teams, for the years during the time of troubles, they were the big nights that the team would make its gate. The way it worked, this team would sell tickets to merchants, three tickets per dollar. And then the merchants would buy lots of tickets, give them their customers. And then the customers would come with lots of kids and pack the stadium in. You can see the statistics for Pony Night. They dwarfed the other attendance high figures for this season. And in 1964, we'll talk about this just briefly, they had a major league game here. The Red Sox played the Cubs, and still Pony Night outdrew the major league game. As Rocco Santilli said, there should be two Pony Nights in 1965. One of the people running the Reading Indians then, and Joe Bootsis, who was a veteran of Pony Night, says one Pony Night a year is enough. Trouble with the bad year in 61. The team had lost money, and Gabe Paul said, I'm tired of paying a $5,750 use tax. I'm tired of paying a city tax on admissions. And the owners, the management of the team said, come down, Gabe, come down, we'll talk to you. And he said, yeah, I'll come down and I'll bring a contract. He said, I'll treat you like gentle people. But he didn't. Instead, on December 17th, 1961, he revoked the franchise. That's Admiral Tojo to the right there on your screen. That's Gabe Paul to the left, lest you confuse them. He sent by telegram notifying the team they lost their franchise. I think he would have texted them nowadays, Charlie.
Probably. That was an odd. You say Indians dead here. That, first of all, that's kind of a pretty gross thing to say. But Dan Zerbe was informed. And I remember the story about him just ready to just have a nervous breakdown. I was so upset about how it was handled. But things were different then. I mean, there were no, the arrangements between major league and minor league clubs were totally different than they are now, especially now. And they could just do whatever they basically wanted, go everywhere they wanted, where the money was best, where the beer sold best, where they got better deals for the hot dogs. And it was a tough time in the early 60s.
Well, what the reaction of the stadium commission was that this was so late, they didn't have any time to talk to any other big league teams.
Right, yeah.
Hence, there was no baseball in Reading in 1962. No professional baseball at the stadium in 1962. But in 1963, the Red Sox were coming. The Red Sox were coming. And Joe Bootsis, who was known as the Marco Polo of the Eastern League, transferred his York Red Sox to Reading. Now, they had been the Johnstown Red Sox. Then they were the Allentown Red Sox. He liked to move from place to place, that Joe Bootsis. And he did. And he moved to Reading in 1963, and people were happy. Except that's a picture of the 64 team, but I couldn't find the 63 team. So there you go. He had a unique way of managing. He was very hands-on. You remember him, Charlie.
He was hands-on to the point where sometimes he was accused of, he was at one time accused of, if you can picture beers being poured, you know, at the tap, fill up a glass, and then there's a lot of drips that go down into the pan, and they go down to a drain. He was accused of, and not convicted legally, but it was determined that he indeed did have a little bottle at the end of the drain that collected the beer and put it back into the fresh beer stuff. He basically recycled the drainage of the beer. And it wasn't, you know, consumed beer. It hadn't gone through the human system, but it did go through the drainage system.
It had been thoroughly aired out.
Yeah,
there you go. Reading Red Sox, the 2 years they were here, and incidentally, those of you who have never gone up and down the cavernous left field under the bleachers in our stadium that Matt Jackson put together a few years ago, it's a chronology of highlights of the Reading Indians and the Reading Red Sox during these years between 1952 and 65, and highlights the players, newspaper articles, and the like. It's a great quasi-baseball museum. Dick Gernert was a player coach, Reading native, teacher at Southwest, and a graduate of Reading High, quite a gentleman. He was the player coach for 2 years. Eddie Popowski was the manager. He was a fire plug. Mike Ryan was on the team. Ultimately, he was a coach with the Phillies for many years. Reggie Smith was on the team for a brief time, had a long and very prosperous career in baseball, or fruitful career. Enrico Pastorelli was an all-star in the American League for a number of years. He was the slugger on the 63 team. There was other players, but we don't have time to talk about the other interesting ones. But there were really very colorful players on those two Red Sox teams. You remember any of them?
Oh, sure. Well, especially Dick Gurney, of course.
Yeah, and sadly, he passed away.
He sure did. He was an actual buddy. We sat together at the ballpark quite often. And Rico Pastorelli, he was like, if you were an American League fan, which very few people were in our area because of the Phillies connection, but Rico Pastorelli was a big surprise to have in Reading. He was a name ball player, and he was fun to watch. That was I was coming of age, 63, 64, and even though the team stank in 63, it was still fun to watch an American League affiliate playing in opposition to the Philadelphia Phillies, which at that time I wasn't a fan of. I was a Yankees fan back then.
Well, the 64 team was colorful.
Hold on a second here before. I can talk about baseball. I want to put a baseball cap on, for God's sake.
I'm sorry.
Get dressed here.
Pick which rabbit you want out of
here
your hat.
Here we go. Okay, now I feel better.
Okay.
Okay, I feel a lot better.
Very quickly, on April 12, 1964, the Reading Red Sox, or the Boston Red Sox, came to town wearing any number of different kind of hats and played the Chicago Cubs. Ernie Banks hit a 450-foot three-run homer over left field. Dick Stewart, playing for the Red Sox, Dr. Strangelove he was, hit a home run off the top of the scoreboard. And Dick Gernert was called the ambassador. He had played both for the Cubs and the Red Sox during his career, and so it was old home week for Dick with introducing the coaches and the like, and so he was very much featured in an article in the Times as the local ambassador to both teams. A test is, six members of the Baseball Hall of Fame played in this game. Who played in this game?
Shoeless Joe Jackson.
All right.
No, I don't know.
Ernie Banks, Billy Williams, Ron Santo, Lou Brock, Carl Yastrzemski, and Dick Williams, but not the other Williams you were thinking.
Teddy.
No, because he had retired. He was done.
Mr. Williams, who owned the Lorraine Orchards in Exeter?
That Williams. Even though the Red Sox increased their attendance by 5,000 people in 1964, Pittsfield offered Joe Bouzas... they didn't have to pay an annual tax. They didn't have to pay a rental. They had he got a deal he couldn't possibly refuse. And as Tessio says, as he's being taken away in Godfather 1, tell him it was strictly business. But he at least came to town to tell them he was not going to marry them, and to tell the team, the people here. And so people had no hard feelings with Joe. It was strictly business. Goodness gracious, what came back? The prodigal Indians. Charleston did not treat the Indians franchise nearly as well as Reading did. They had worse attendance in Charleston. It really was bad there. The Reading Red Sox drew 7,000 people more than the Charleston Indians did in 1964. So it was so bad, they just left town. And here's where we had municipal organization. Midnight meetings. Rocco Santilli was the coach of the Rising Sun fast pitch softball team. John Kramer was at that time the owner of the Rising Sun Hotel and the sponsor of the team. They were, and Joe Kosminski was a councilman. They were all very proactive. They wanted to get the franchise back. So a night of phone calls. And after agreeing to pay $13,500 as a franchise fee and $5,000 as initial stadium rent on behalf of the team, they had a deal to bring the Indians back to Reading. Hmm. And it didn't work out so good.
Whoa.
They hired Whitey Kurowski, which you... Oh, yeah, I know. That was with Pony Night. Whitey Kurowski was a World Series hero, 1941. He was a great third baseman with the Cardinals. But people don't come to see the manager. They come to see the players. And the players were too young. They were overmatched. They did not... they were in last place. They were in last place with the gate. And except for Pony Knight, they drew... less, you know, they did well. But Pony Knight drew 7,900. Dairy Knight drew 2,200. So that was like 30,000 divided. There was about 400 people a game other than those two nights. So that they left. Paul Dickens led the team with, Ray Fossey was an 18-year-old rookie on the team.
He had a pretty good career, though.
He had a wonderful career.
Paul Dickens, not so much.
Paul Dickens, 23 years that year. And Sam Perilla, the high point of his career, was getting traded for Roger Fried. Yeah. So a second farewell to the Indians was that Cleveland pulls the rug out the second time. Rocky Santilli wants the franchise fee back because they didn't condition it on anything other than they were giving it for good faith. Gabe Paul wouldn't give it back to him. And if you ask Rocky, who is a gentleman par excellence, he will say that across day from Gabe Paul's desk, he said, "Where I come from, they call you a bleeping thief." And he says that with pride. Yes.
I'm shocked.
It shocked you, I'm saying. Shocked.
For another hat.
Oh, boy. Okay. So looking at the trend here, it starts in green. That's good things. It goes to yellow. That's not so good things. And then ends up red. And that's where our time of troubles really had troubles in time. You're not going to digest this on your home screen, but when you watch it again, you can look closely at all these fascinating numbers here that took hours to assemble.
I remember going to a game one time, the paid attendance was 98. And Joe Bouzas came out of the wherever he was tapping beer and told a guy who had one of those big horns, whoo, you know, those big plastic horns, told him he couldn't use them. He was down in the box and stuff because it was scaring everybody. It was so loud. That's the only noise that was being made other than the occasional applause. Oh, those were different days.
Occasional applause, yeah. So, yeah, that's the red part there. And the time of troubles ends when in 1966, the Phillies agree that they're going to move their Macon franchise to Reading, but they couldn't do it until 1967. Hmm. So in 1967, the Reading Phillies, in opening day, defeat the York White Roses in front of a crowd of 6,046, which John Smith, the Rye writer for the Reading Eagle, noted was 4.5 times the opening night crowd for the last 5 openers together. They usually didn't draw them well. And incidentally, you can see that crowd. There's no ponies. That was a genuine 6,000-person crowd. Just if you're curious, the time of troubles in Russia ended in 1613 when Michael Romanov was elected Tsar by the National Assembly, if you're keeping score at home.
How many are? How many are keeping score? Raise your hand. 46?
46. Okay.
That's great.
Gabe Paul... his quote is, "I don't like Reading, I never liked Reading, and I wouldn't give you 2 cents for the town." I don't think he is ever going to be elected to the Reading Baseball Hall of Fame. Maybe you disagree with
that. No,
me. No. So, welcome back, Baseball 2021, and we are so happy to be able to go out and enjoy this. And I just, you hearken back, it was 50 years ago, since we had the problem of not having a professional game going at the stadium, which hit all of us right between the chops, yes, last year. And that's a winsome picture and a nice picture, a nice place to visit. So there.
Very good.
Got it done. Excellent. In 26 minutes.
Yes, you did, yeah.
Even though I talk fast.
Okay. Now, what do you think, Vicky? Do you know all that stuff?
No, I didn't know all that stuff, but I have been learning from Brian. I've attended many of his programs. Yeah. So thank you for joining us tonight with the Berks History Center, and thank you, Brian Engelhardt and Charlie Adams, for doing this great program for us.
Thank you.